Imagine you need a controller which will return a list of objects. Let's say your controller will return a list of DTO. For simplicity, here I have put string. So my controller is returning list of students. So this controller is fine, but what if we want a little bit more control of our response? Like we want to add a custom header in our response, or let's say we want to return a different status code instead of 200. When we need this kind of things, that's when response entity comes into play. Response entity gives us more fine-grained control over our HTTP response. So let's run this and see what this controller returns. This controller returning this array of string. So now let's update our example controller with response entity. So to return a response entity, we'll return response entity of this return type, and we'll return a response entity. So let's create a new variable and return our response entity of these students with a status code of 200. If I run the project once again and go to the browser, let's refresh this page. As you can see here, we are getting the same response now. So previous controller and this controller is pretty much same, but in this controller we have more control over what HTTP status code we are returning. So instead of 200, we can send 202, which is for accepted. If I rerun the application and refresh the page, then I can see that HTTP status code of 202 is returned, which is for accepted. This is very useful when we want to handle an unauthorized case, like we want to throw an exception and we want to return a different status code like 401 or 403 for failed authorization or authentication. Another important use case for response entity is when we want to have a custom header in our response. So let's say we want to add a new response header in our HTTP response. In the earlier approach where we are returning list of string from controller, we wouldn't able to do that. But now, since we are returning response entity, we can add a HTTP headers in our response. So for that, I'm declaring new variable as HTTP headers and adding a new header to this header. Let's say I want to add a new header as this is the key for my custom header, and the value for this is take with monitor. Okay, let's add this header to my response entity. Let's rerun this application now and check out on browser what it returns. If I refresh the page and go to my response, I can see that this is returning a status code of 202 and it have a response header called x youtube detail. The value of this is take with Monir. Okay, so this is what we can achieve with response entity, but cannot achieve with typical list return. So if you do not need to add a custom header or do not need to customize your response status code, then you can simply return responses for the HTTP request body. That is totally fine. But when you need a more fine-grained control, then you can use response entity. And one thing I want to share about response entity is this thing comes from Spring Web. If I go to the library from which this thing is imported, I'll see that this thing comes from Spring Web. So when we add Spring Boot Starter Web, this thing is included in your project, and this response entity class extends the HTTP entity, which is a boilerplate for HTTP response in Spring application. So this response entity represents the full HTTP response in our application, and this response entity have few constructor. We can use that as we need. So I hope you got the idea why we need response entity, what benefits we can get with this. In the next tutorial, we'll see how you can use response entity when a runtime exception occurs in our application. Thank you so much for watching.